Dydh Da. Hello. Last time, we looked at the very limited information on the Kernowec Paleolithic period and discussed what it might mean. In this video, we're going to be looking at Kernow during the Mesolithic and once again give a more general overview. This will be the only other period where we don't delve deeper, at least for now, due to limited knowledge and evidence, albeit far more than the Paleolithic. But first of all, the British Mesolithic period is broadly understood to last from about 9600 to 4000 BCE, so shortly after the end of the last ice age, and until around the time farming arrives in Britain. If we look closer at Kernow, we have limited exact dating to go off of. However, there were charred nuts dated from Poldarian farm in the Lizard to about 4500 BCE, and charcoal from Windmill Farm, again in the Lizard, dated to about 4210 BCE. Combine this with Westwood Ho in Devon, which came up with dates from about 5005 to 4635 BCE, and we're painting a picture of late Mesolithic occupation in Kernow, at the very least perhaps significant occupation happening only during the late Mesolithic. Though, due to limited evidence, this is more biased towards what little we know than what may actually be the case. So, before we look at Kernow specifically, let's just get a quick overview of the general and British Mesolithic periods. The Mesolithic experienced major landscape changes due to climate change, like expanding woodlands in southwest Britain, and extreme coastal change in northern and western Europe, as Doggerland submerges, shown once again in our favourite map from the Paleolithic video. It is during the Mesolithic and these sea level rises that resulted in Kernow's rivers and estuaries and, in fact, coastline taking on a more modern form as seen today, rather than the paleo channels and landscapes of old. One thing which will become important when discussing Kernow is that evidence across Europe suggests tidal estuaries, that is to say locations where salt and freshwater mix and subject to tidal changes, were very popular sites to occupy, likely due to such regions being rich in resources and food, and relatively easy to exploit. The Mesolithic is also characterised by certain technological advances, such as more advanced hunting techniques like barbed flint arrowheads, as well as the development of fishing and simple maritime travel, aka boats. Now, zooming in on Kernow, activity can be seen across the duchy, unlike the Paleolithic, and this is from West Penwith and the Lizard, right up to Bodmin Moor and Bude. Much of the early flint and tool collections from investigations into the Kernowec Mesolithic have now sadly been lost or spread out across unknown private collections, such as most famously J.G. Marden's pre-World War I work in West Penwith. Despite this, enough evidence does exist, especially from post-World War II works, from individuals like Charles Thomas and organisations like the Cornish Archaeological Society and Cornish Archaeological Unit. And we'll delve into four key Mesolithic sites now, before then looking at the Isles of Scilly and finally discussing what we can infer about the Kernowec Mesolithic period. So, firstly, we have Windmill and Poldarian farms in the Lizard Peninsula, which provided two valuable radiometric dates as mentioned earlier, but have also produced large amounts of late Mesolithic flint, including worked flint and even pebble tools and quartzite hammer stones. Poldarian also contained an incised pebble, which is a really significant find. Now that might not mean much to people at first, but it's actually a form of art, and so would be the earliest real indication of art in Kernow. Though, as you might be able to tell, a lot of this art is quite hard for us to understand today. And then in this figure, you can see that there are others found across the UK, but they are still relatively uncommon in Britain, and their meanings largely unknown and still debated. Then there's the Gwithian Sands area, near the Hale Estuary, and particularly Godrevy Beach, which is full of evidence for Mesolithic occupation where they utilise the flint that washes up on the shores. This is an important occurrence, as flint is not actually naturally found in Kernow, and so has to be collected when it either washes up on the northern shores, or else brought from Devon. Now, most of this evidence is actually called debitage, which is simply waste material from working a piece of flint when creating flint tools. But flint cores, scrapers, blade flakes, microburins, and microliths have been found as well. Particular finds of importance are the so-called limpet scoops, which are elongated pebbles with chipped or beveled ends, used for, unsurprisingly, scooping up limpets, which, for those who don't know, are aquatic mollusks that stick to rocks. A nice, tasty Mesolithic food source, essentially. In total, thousands of individual finds have been uncovered from the Gwithian's region, although most are very small debitage and flakes. Next we have Trevose Head, a site suggested by R.M. Jacobi as being a permanent occupation area, with easy access to coastal and inland food and resources from the mid-Mesolithic onwards, when it became coastal. From just one site, TV1, over 8,000 pieces of worked flint have been recorded. And another incised pebble was actually discovered, from the original Trevose Head flint collection, by Emmett O'Keefe. And as you can see, such incisions are incredibly hard to see by the naked eye, compared to the drawings that I'm showing now, which serve to highlight them. So you can sort of see why this is missed. This stuff essentially isn't really easy to spot, and again, the meaning of the incisions are hard for us to interpret. Finally, there's Bodmin Moor, a relatively large area deep inland in central North Kernow, with several different Mesolithic sites found within, such as Dosmary Pool, Butterstore, and Crowdy Marsh Reservoir. During the Mesolithic, birch trees, and later oak and hazel, would spread across all but the highest areas of what is now open moorland. Dosmary Pool in particular is significant, now believed to be a flint manufacturing site for processing flint pebbles collected from the north coast. Indeed, hundreds of microliths, often believed to be arrowheads and points of spears and blades, have been discovered here, at the very least indicating that occupation and even hunting was occurring nearby. Before concluding, I did just want to have a quick discussion on the Isles of Scilly as a separate entity to mainland Kernow. So there's no actual Mesolithic history agreed upon for this archipelago, which was largely still one island off the coast of Kernow during the Mesolithic. That said, around 60 microliths have been found on the isles, at Old Key, and they hint at potential cross-channel contact and travel, perhaps to a greater and further extent than is currently thought. Prior to a 2013 investigation, it was believed that the Scilly Isles were first permanently inhabited during the Bronze Age, and perhaps sparsely visited during the Neolithic, for seasonal hunting and fishing. However, this excavation changed things, and interestingly, the closest parallel for the types of microliths found here most resemble not something in southern Britain or Kernow, but in France, Belgium, and the Netherlands, though there are small differences. Now that's quite fascinating, and there are three theories as to what this might mean. Number one, an individual or group travelled from Western Europe to Scilly, and stayed there long enough to not only make the same type of microliths, but for that type to differ and evolve over time, separate to the mainland. Number two, in the sort of opposite direction, someone from Scilly or the nearby area travelled to Western Europe, picked up the style and travelled back, perhaps making them quite well travelled for the time, granted, but it is still perfectly plausible. And then number three, that there was regular, maintained contact between people in or visiting Scilly and northern France or Belgium or Holland, likely as a result of one of the first two theories, which would enable the manufacturing technique to remain largely similar in the two locations over the long term. In any case, it's a significant finding that promotes the idea of cross-channel sea travel during the late Mesolithic to a much greater extent than is usually agreed, and also perhaps extends the story of Scilly further than previously thought, beyond even the Neolithic, though it must be stated that there is still not enough evidence to conclusively argue this, but it at least points to the idea being more plausible. So, back to Kernow. What does all of this actually mean? What was actually happening during the Mesolithic? Well, first of all, it tells us that activity in the region was a lot higher and more consistent than the Paleolithic, that it occurred right across the duchy, rather than sticking to rivers and South Devon caves. Also, clearly via the amount of evidence at each major site, these locations were visited more than once, if not outright occupied permanently, or at regular periods throughout the year. They weren't one-off events like during the Paleolithic. We can also begin to understand the local populations living in Kernow a little bit more. They became adept at using the unique Kernowic landscape, for example understanding where to find flint in Kernow, along the northern coastline, and where the perfect locations were for food, like the estuaries and coastal rocks full of fish or limpets. There is knowledge clearly being passed down here, going through the generations on how best to utilise the Kernowic and likely wider southwestern landscapes to their advantage, which gives rise to the idea of a distinct southwestern British territory, and perhaps even culture, for the first time in history, something argued by archaeologist Malcolm Todd. Now, these Mesolithic peoples and this potential southwestern culture are not Celtic, those Celts still being a long way off from spreading their culture into Britain, which we'll get to eventually. However, this is the beginning of true Kernowic settlement in history, and if these people were more permanently occupying and remaining in Kernow after all, then potentially also the beginnings of our Kernowic genetic heritage and tradition too. Dugenis ha maraz. Thank you, and goodbye.